Okay, good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for coming to this very special opportunity to engage some experts in the field of teenage drug use and early intervention from parents. We really appreciate your support. Those of you who were members of our community last year might have remembered that we stumbled through some difficult times earlier in our school year, which required a lot of collaboration between the adults in the building and throughout the community so that we could get a better understanding of just what we could do as adults to intervene as early as possible in the lives of our children. We all know that they're our most important and most beloved natural resource, and we want to make sure that we take care of them as best we can. So we reached out to just about every entity that we could last year to find a solution to the problem that we had in our school, which in the grand scheme of things might seem pretty small, but for a small community like ours, it was something that definitely needed our attention. Spoke to Ms. Ehrman over the summer about this, and she was determined to make sure that we got a gathering together of parents and experts to discuss this issue and to better prepare us for future instances of this sort. So tonight we have such an opportunity. We're going to hope to use this as leverage to build on this and make this an even more robust program that we can use to engage our students. Before I begin proper, I'd like to recognize a few people from our city who are in the audience here. I see Mr. Sharp from the school board. We appreciate you being here this evening. Mr. Conklin from Court Services is also with us this evening. Ms. Kurjanowicz is the director of our counseling office is here at the school, and she's here with us this evening. Ms. Germer, Special Education Director, Student Services, is also with us. Anyone else I'm missing? Big wigs out there? All right. Well, thank you all. And who's that behind you just came in, Earl? Mr. Fassell, I don't speak his name because he's a Redskin fan. We don't get along. I'm just sorry. I'm just playing, Mr. Fassell. Thank you so much for being here this evening. Yes. Oh, great. Oh, thank you for being here, and thank you for your organizational leadership in this. All right, so let's introduce the panel that are up here this evening to speak with us. Ms. Jennifer Lewis Cooper is here with us. Mr. Greg Lanis, am I pronouncing that correctly?
Lanis,
okay. His wife, Donna Lanis. Thank you for being here. Ms. Karen Case, who works for the school system as a drug prevention specialist, drug abuse prevention specialist. Is that correct, Karen?
Yes.
That's about right. All right. So I'm going to turn it over to them, and they're going to lead us through our discussion this evening. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jennifer Lewis Cooper. I'm coordinator for PROTECT. PROTECT stands for Parents Reaching Out to Educate Communities Together. And we formed about 2 years ago, almost 3 years ago now, in the winter of 2009. As a result of, I'm sure you all read about it, the heroin ring out in the western part of Fairfax County, Westfield, Chantilly, Centerville area, parents in that community really felt the need to do something. There was the heroin whole outbreak, the conspiracy, and they really felt a need to reach out to other parents to let them know that there is help in our county, that parents don't have to go through something like this alone. And this kind of thing can happen to good families. And so we formed, and we meet once a month on the second Monday of the month out at the Chantilly ADS office. And we just started out as parents, and we brought in ADS, the alcohol and drug specialists from the county. Parents and teachers and PTAs kind of all formed, and we started talking as a panel to other groups, high schools. We've been to all the police station citizen advisory committee meetings to talk to community members and just raise awareness and to let you know that there is help out there. This doesn't happen to have to happen to everyone, but it can. This evening, we have a wonderful young adult that's part of our panel. Her name is Taylor Gibson. She was part of the heroin ring. There's an article out on the table out, along with other materials, about Taylor and what she went through. She can't be with us this evening. She texted me about an hour ago. She's probably going into labor as we speak. She's going to have a baby. So we were counting on her to be here. She was with us last night at a presentation. But I thought I'd just tell you a little bit about her story. If you saw Taylor, she's about 5 foot, cutest little thing that you ever did see. And you would never think that she would have gotten mixed up in heroin. But what happened to Taylor, you can kind of tell what led to her involvement in using drugs. When she was about 13, her mother suffered a severe, she went into a coma. She suffered a stroke, and it turned their family upside down. A lot of effort had to go into caring for her mother. She was in a coma. All the family turned to her, and a lot of attention was given to the mother. And Taylor and her two brothers were kind of left on their own. She was 13. I think she has an older brother and a younger brother. And they're good kids, they were pretty independent. So Taylor went on through middle school and high school. She joined the field hockey team in high school. She was part of Young Life. She did well in school. Everything was going along quite well, and as Taylor says, she really condoned people that used drugs, smoked, or drank. That wasn't part of her lifestyle. Well, Taylor became very independent as a result of her family tragedy. Her mother is fine now, just so you know. But through that course of those teen years when she was developing, she did become independent. She got a part-time job at a restaurant when she was about 17. And she worked with older kids at this restaurant. You can understand college kids coming home and working or going to school here. And so she was being mixed in with an older crowd. And this older crowd went after work, they went to the bars and they partied, and they started smoking marijuana. And at first she was very against it, but she got roped in, and she started drinking with them, and then she started experimenting with marijuana. And along the way, she had several boyfriends that helped her along with this. And she just became that became her group of friends. And so she went through a very few ordeals. She got caught with smoking over in the West Springfield area. She was able to talk her way out of it. She was in a car with a boyfriend, and they were smoking, but she convinced her parents that it wasn't her car. They had no idea that there was marijuana in the car. The police wrote her up, but there was some technicality, so she never suffered any consequences as a result of that incident. This group of kids that she started hanging out with started, including her boyfriend, to delve into use of heroin. And she was very afraid of it at first, and she thought to herself, this was her reasoning, that she could either just walk away and not partake, or she could try it and be part of the group. Well, she chose the bad decision of being part of the group and used marijuana or heroin. And it doesn't take much to get addicted, and that's what happened. It became something that she had to have. She was accepted to VCU. She spent about 2 weeks at VCU down in Richmond and couldn't handle it and came back home. She tried to go to Nova, and she didn't do well in her classes and didn't go to class. It was all about the next time she was going to get a hit, next time she was going to have heroin. Throughout this whole thing, she was able to, her parents, I think, knew something was going on with her, but really couldn't figure out what was going on. What led to her finally getting caught, it was kind of a mixed blessing. One of her friends asked her to go down to D.C. to buy some heroin. And she had no transportation. Her boyfriend had been arrested and was put in jail. She had no means of getting a supply of heroin, so she and her friend drove down to D.C. After taking her mother's car without permission and bought heroin down there, and were coming back, and she was in a crash. She crashed the car. The bumper fell off. As she tells, she had to pick up the bumper and put it in the car. And the whole way home, she's trying to figure out what she's going to tell her parents. She's lied her way through several other incidences and convinced her parents that she wasn't using. So she finally decided to admit that she was a heroin addict and she needed help. She thought that would divert their attention from her stealing the mother's car and taking it and wrecking it. And so her parents did take her to the hospital and tried to go through a detox program. throughout this whole thing, the whole heroin ring was starting to be, they found out about it. One of her young friends, which you'll hear their story in a little while, died of an overdose. She had gone to school with the Lannis' daughter back in preschool, and they had grown up together through high school. She had died of an overdose. She lost a few other friends along the way. None of these things deterred her, though, from still abusing drugs. What happened was the police showed up at her house one day as a result of the heroin ring and the investigation, and she was told she would be notified that her case was going to go federal. The FBI was involved now, and she should wait and hear what was going to happen later. And the Lannis's will fill you in on what took place with Taylor and some of her other friends. Taylor is a convicted criminal. She has to do 5 years of probation. She's got to do 200 hours of community service. She can't vote. Here's this young person that had everything going for her in her life, but she took some wrong turns. She had a major tragedy in her life with her family and her mother, and that led her to kind of not express herself, and it just sort of led, you can just kind of see as we talk this evening on what something like that tragedy can do to a young person when they don't seek help and they don't reach out to other people. And they go down this path of using drugs and alcohol. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Greg Lannis. He's going to, or do you want to go first, Donna? Would you rather?
Donna, go first.
Okay, Donna. Donna's going to tell the story of their family tragedy about their daughter, Alicia. And I'll let you start, Donna. Go
ahead. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you for being here tonight and inviting us to come to your school and talk with you all. You know, I've heard Taylor tell that story, I don't know, many times. You did a great job,
thank
by
you.
The way. But Alicia and who was my daughter and Taylor were very good friends in preschool and all through up to about sixth grade. And then they kind of went their separate ways, going to different schools. And then just to give you an idea of that, the impact of her mother's illness, her mother had that brain aneurysm. One day in, I think, 10th grade, Alicia came home and, you know, typical, I just asked her how her day went, and she said, you know, she goes, Mom, Taylor was upset all day at school today. And I'm like, Taylor Gibson? And she said, yeah. And I said, well, you haven't seen her in years. And she said, yeah, but she goes, you know, just kind of in and out, I've always kind of kept touch with Taylor. And I said, well, why was she so upset today? And she goes, well, it's Taylor's birthday today. And her mom had no memory of her birthday at all and didn't do anything for her birthday, or so that was Taylor, what Taylor was going through. That just a little side remembrance that I had while you were talking. So my name is Donna Lannis, and Alicia Lannis is and was my daughter. I am not a public speaker, nor am I an expert on drug abuse. Privately, I love to talk about Alicia, so I'm sure everyone here can understand. It is difficult to talk about Alicia to strangers that did not know her character or her values. We speak and expose Alicia to try to relate with you. We really could be you. I am also here for Alicia and the message she wanted to deliver. I am here for this entire community and especially young women. Perhaps you are here tonight because you have an instinct, a gut-level feeling that you or a friend has a problem with drugs in your household. For those parents who don't think they have an issue but are petrified that this is in our community, God bless you for being here tonight. I don't know why some kids choose to use. Perhaps all it takes is simple access or a vulnerable moment. I do know that even after our experience, I am certain I could not point out a future drug user if they were standing here right next to me. So if you have a feeling, then I ask you to listen carefully to these people on the panel. Listen to Taylor, beautiful young girl that she is. I wish she was here tonight. And our other parents that are usually here for on our panel, please pay attention and draw on their resources and follow your instincts. Listen to their perspective, even though it may not fit yours perfectly. I do believe you were placed here in this particular school on this particular night for a very real reason. You are part of this community. You will need to draw on this information for your child's life or to help your neighbor. You will find it will not have just been luck or coincidence that you're sitting here tonight, right this minute. I'm also here to be a voice for Alicia. Her goal in this life was to speak out for young women everywhere, to empower them to find their voice and to be heard. When she was 14 years old, she was the victim of sexual abuse. At that very tender age, in her beautiful, innocent, and loving mind, she made a decision. To protect us, to protect those she loved, she made a conscious decision to keep it a secret, to carry on her life without giving it a second thought so as not to burden those that loved her most. Alicia thought she could do that. In her young mind, she thought she could do that. Seems absurd to you and me, but not to her. She was a very brave, strong, independent young lady, but no one is that strong. Her days were filled with anxiety, nightmares, and flashbacks. She chose to hide a terrible injustice. She began to understand that her secret was going to be her undoing, and it was undoing her. We lost our Alicia when she was 14 years old. And we lost her again at 19 from an overdose as she fought post-traumatic stress disease. Someone convinced her he had something that could help her, a vulnerable moment. Physiologically, drugs killed our Alicia. Heroin stopped her breathing. Alicia and I were very close. She loved to talk to me. We spent lots of time at home. We played lots of card and board games. She was an honor student, a student athlete, a volunteer, well-liked, regular kid. She rarely went to parties, rarely drank alcohol. Her and Taylor were a lot the same in their mindset of, you know, that is just something they just would never touch. She made it through high school and given admission to a university with 18 college credits. In many ways, Alicia was a young woman, just like your child, and we are parents just like you. I'm not here to talk to you about warning signs. Some of you may want to hear us tell of the earliest, smallest, or faintest sign that we missed. In retrospect and by the grace of God, we don't have those regrets. I never saw suspicious-looking people. No drug paraphernalia. No missing money. No extra money. No burnt spoons or tin cans, cotton balls, etc. My profession is a registered nurse, so I am aware of physical signs like the pinpoint pupils, lethargy, and slurred speech. She was in intense counseling for post-traumatic stress disease for over a year, and we knew she was vulnerable to potential drug use. We were diligent about this. She graduated Westfield High School in June of 2007. Prior to August of 2007, we did not see any signs of drug activity. I am here to tell you that every child, even your regular kid living a regular life, is vulnerable to drugs. Every child has a reason to try drugs. And every child is capable of lying to cover the use of drugs. Alicia was no different than many kids, but her story is not only about drug awareness. I have a lot of memories that I hold very dear. I have a few physical items, one of which is this bracelet. It was hers, and before that it belonged to her cousin. Alicia wore it all the time, and one day she lost the little silver ball on one end. Alicia was mortified. She cried and she cried. She felt she had lost another part of something that had belonged to her, something that was very dear to her. Now I wear it. And sometimes that little area that's missing the silver ball gives me the slightest little pinch And I have to grin. It makes me smile because I know my Alicia is, at that very moment, reminding me of her presence. And I thank my God for that moment. So if you're a young woman here tonight, I want to begin to encourage you to always be your own best advocate. No one can be your voice stronger, louder, and mightier than yourself. Do not be afraid anymore. As fragile as you may feel, only by shattering your silence will a stronger, more powerful you emerge. Transparency will not break you, but I can promise you that you will eventually explode carrying the pressure of silence. Never, never let a so-called friend mislead you to believe he has the drug that can make you feel better. No drug will give you peace. Only one thing will do that for you. Only faith and the truth will give you the power to survive. Be open and honest with those who truly love you and allow their love and your faith to give you strength to deal with your challenges. This is the message Alicia would want me to share with you tonight. Thank you very much.
Alicia died March 5th, 2008. We were awoken to a phone call at 5:30 in the morning from her boyfriend, and at the same time, EMTs, the police department, and fire department were pounding on our door. Can you guys hear me? I'm not sure if the mic is carrying.
Yeah.
So, obviously, we were in panic. We didn't know what was going on. We ran downstairs. We opened the door. My wife was talking to her boyfriend, who wasn't making sense other than crying on the phone. And the police said that there's a young lady that's reported in trouble in this home. We ran downstairs to her bedroom, where we found her lifeless body laying on the floor. My wife and I don't have to tell the story to the community. We've talked a lot, and we both came to the same conclusion that how could we not tell our story that may help somebody, help a parent never go through what we went through that morning, to see your child not alive and them and her being sewn up into a body bag and carried out of the house. Her death was a catalyst for Fairfax County Police Department to launch an investigation into her death. What they found was they found this heroin ring. It became a very large operation. They brought in the FBI because it crossed jurisdictional lines. And in the end, 16 individuals were arrested and charged federally for conspiracy to distribute and conspiracy with the intent to distribute. Of the 16, four in particular were associated to my daughter's death. Her boyfriend, who gave her the heroin, person that sold it to him, person that sold it to him, all the way to the kingpin in DC. All four received federal sentences of 20 plus years. That's tragic as well. These families, many of them that we've known in the community, we didn't know them personally, but we know of their stories, and many of them are similar. They come from good homes. However, they took and made bad choices that led to now their lives having a tragic ending as well, in some cases losing all of their youth and spending it in federal prison, which I don't know if many of you know this, there's no parole in federal prison. If they give you a sentence of 20 years, you will do 20 years. So it's tragic in our community as well, not only the loss of our daughter, but these 16 individuals that are now convicted federal, on their record. And that's going to affect them their entire lives. But the one thing that we are grateful that they were arrested and they were stopped, because their actions that were also associated with three other deaths in our community, it would have continued. And it would have gotten more people addicted, and the cycle would have kept going on. So we thank God that that this was stopped. At least this particular ring was stopped. We've talked about, how does this happen? Well, it happens. And the more research that we've done on ADS and Fairfax County Youth Survey, working with the professionals and so forth, we've kind of pieced together, you know, a lot of how this happens in our community. It crosses all demographics. There's nobody immune to getting into drugs and alcohol and abusing them. And certainly the Fairfax County Youth Survey, which this school does not take because I believe it's in the city of Falls Church, so it falls under that. But the entire county does take this youth survey. So it does correlate to what's going on as well in this community. What the survey shows is part of what's kind of going on with our kids. The survey shows that a little over 30% of our kids say that they feel depressed within the last 30 days, severely depressed. When you're talking about 80,000 students in Fairfax County, that's a large number. We know that students, teenagers, are a high-risk category anyway. But when you add on things like what they're going through, being depressed, and this may not be clinical depression, but they feel it, right? And perception to a teenager is reality. That's a bucket of kids that kind of go into a bigger, large, high risk. You got, I believe the numbers is 52% said that they've been bullied in the course of their high school career. That's a lot. And that's also putting kids into high risk. You also have, at least last year's survey showed that 4% said that they've been raped. That's another 3,200 kids that go into this bucket. So what it's telling us is that we have what our kids are telling us. And as a community, it starts at home first, but as a community, we need to look after our youth. We need to look after them in school, extracurricular activities, at home, what's going on. We need to help our neighbors out. As a community, we can impact. You can impact in your own neighborhood and make decisions by telling your neighbor, hey, I see your son, he's been sneaking in and out at 1 o'clock in the morning. That's important. The parents may not know, obviously they don't know, they wouldn't allow him, he wouldn't be sneaking out, but you may stop him from abusing drugs or getting into trouble and so forth. You may even save his life. By stepping forward and doing something like that, you may save a life that you'll never know, and that's okay. But that one life, like the life in our family, it's got such a rippling effect for generations to come. And you may never even know what you did, but you're one of those silent heroes out there. When I was young, we used to say, hey, I got your back, and protect our friends. In the past 30 years, I think that's changing. Kids nowadays say that they've got their friends back. What has changed, and we need, as a community, need to help change this, is that having your back today means go ahead and do what you're going to do. I won't tell anybody. I won't tell the police. I won't tell your parents. Go ahead and do it. We need to change that. When I was younger, having your back was if they were going to do something that was going to harm themselves or another person, we were going to fight first before you did that. We need to tell our youth that that's no longer any good. Because I'm tired of seeing when somebody passes away from a drug abuse or alcohol or drunk driving, having candlelight vigils, them crying and holding each other's hands and saying, oh, if I have only did this, if I only stopped them from doing that. You have your chance to stop that. Step up and be a hero and stop your friends or your neighbors from doing something that could hurt themselves. We give you an idea of in Fairfax County, the survey says now that's kind of what's driving our kids into a high risk. 38% lifetime use, they reported, of alcohol, Yeah, 38% of drug use in the lifetime of their school in Fairfax County. And that means in their lifetime, they may only used it once, they may abuse it, but they reported that they've used drugs. That's a lot of kids. I think the number lifetime use in Fairfax County is over 50% alcohol. Just as a senior, they're reporting, lifetime use with alcohol is 69%, which equates to be 53,000 kids. As a 12th grader, 39%. So when you put these numbers together, when your kid leaves to go to school, depending on which survey you look at, they have a 1 in 2 or a 2 in 3 chance that sometime when they're going to off to school or to some of those activities after school, that they may be involved in this. Parents, trust your instinct. If you think something's going on, quite frankly, it probably is. And this was going to lead us to some of the services that are available in Fairfax County, including the school. I believe they have ADS here.
Mm-hmm. Karen.
And she's going to, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
You mean in the school?
In the school. Some of the services that are available to you that you may or may not know.
Hi, everyone. My name is Karen Case, and I am a substance abuse counselor with the Fairfax Falls Church Community Services Board in the Wellness and Health Promotion Division. And I've been asked to be a part of the panel tonight to talk briefly about signs and symptoms, resources, and three to succeed. We're going to start and talk a little bit about signs and symptoms. It's interesting, as Donna mentioned, signs and symptoms can be really hard to notice. So even for parents who are looking, they can be hard to see. So it's a good idea to kind of get some education and learn about what some of the signs and symptoms are so that you can at least try to be looking for them. Sometimes they will be blatant and you'll notice them. Once a kid starts to get out of control, you can't help but notice the signs. But sometimes they're really good at hiding what they're doing and kind of keeping this facade that everything is going just fine. So some signs and symptoms in terms of physical signs, and all of this is on a handout on the table out there. If you haven't gotten one, you can get one before you leave tonight. So physical signs can be things like loss of appetite, increase in appetite, any kind of significant change in eating habits, unexplained weight loss or weight gain, slowed or staggering walk. Obviously, if someone is walking around and they're looking uncoordinated or their speech is slurred, that's a sign that they may be intoxicated at that time. Problem sleeping. This could be that they're sleeping way more than they usually have in the past, or they're having a real hard time sleeping. They're waking up at odd hours. Red, watery eyes, changes in the size of the pupils, puffy face, blushing or being really pale, the smell of a substance on a person's breath, their body, their clothes. If you have an adolescent that can drive, maybe in the car, the smell can be the smell of alcohol. It can be the smell of smoke from any kind of tobacco product, marijuana, the synthetic cannabinoid products. It could be, if the child is abusing, inhalants, could be a very chemically smell that you might notice. Extreme hyperactivity, excessive talkativeness, any kind of needle marks on the body, nausea, vomiting, excessive sweating, tremors or shakes, and an irregular heartbeat. In terms of behavioral signs, there's lots of behavioral signs. And again, this is by no means an exhaustive list, but this is just a way to kind of give you an idea of some things to be looking for. Significant change in your adolescent's overall attitude and personality with no identifiable cause or reason. Significant change in their friends. So they don't want to hang out with this group of friends anymore. They have all new friends. If they're hanging out with a group of friends that are known to be substance users, that's definitely a warning sign for parents. If someone is kind enough and brave enough to come to you and tell you that, hey, I think your son or daughter is hanging out with a group of kids that's drinking or using drugs, you know, listen, take that seriously. Any kind of change in activities or hobbies, dropping out of things, a decline in their performance in, you know, important aspects of their life, such as school, declining grades, if they have a part-time job or they're involved in club activities, decline in those things, attendance issues in terms of chronic tardiness, skipping classes, skipping whole days of school. Sudden oversensitivity, moodiness, irritability, or nervousness, that's a change from their normal behavior, silliness or giddiness, paranoia, an excessive need for privacy, being secretive, any kind of suspicious activity. Again, if your gut is telling you something's going on, take a look at it. If they went from, you know, if the adolescent went from being okay with you, their parents, you know, being around while they're talking on the phone or using the internet or texting, and then suddenly they don't want you around any of it. They're very vague about who they're hanging out with, and they don't want you to know where they're going. Those kinds of secretive things, that can be a sign that's related to substance abuse. Chronic dishonesty, a lot of lying goes on to cover up the behaviors. Unexplained need for money, stealing money or items from the home can be a sign. I talk to parents quite a bit about what they're seeing with their child, and sometimes, along with a lot of other things, they do notice that, you know, something strange. They just started noticing $20 bills missing from their wallet and $10 bills here and there, and they didn't know where it was going, and they thought they were losing their mind for a while, and then they found out their child was stealing from them. Possession of drug paraphernalia. Now, that one seems pretty obvious. The thing with the paraphernalia, I mean, if you find it, that's an obvious sign. One interesting thing with paraphernalia is that the paraphernalia can be pretty overt. I mean, if you see it, you know what it is, and you can recognize it. Other times, the paraphernalia can be really subtle, depending on what substance the child is using and how they're using it. If they're abusing over-the-counter medications, for example, that come in the little pill packs, like the cold medicines that have dextromethorphan, it could be the little empty bubble packs that you might find that look innocent enough. Could be something like if they're abusing inhalants, having household products in the room, something as innocent as a water bottle. Usually a water bottle is just a water bottle, but even something like a water bottle can be used to store, transport alcohol, and then also it can be used along with other kind of beverage containers to be turned into a smoking device. So those are some really things that you might look at and think, this is really innocent, and you wouldn't think twice if you saw it in your kid's room. What I'm suggesting is just have a more skeptical eye and just be aware that these things exist. If the key is, you know, if you see a significant change. So if you see a significant change in your child's physical appearance, personality, attitude, or behavior, you start seeing some of these signs or you just know something's wrong, that's when it's time to seek professional help. And you can get help in a lot of different places. Some professionals that you can talk to about this kind of issue is counselors at the school. There's some alcohol and drug counselors at schools right now. There's also the school counselor and other clinicians at the school. A pediatrician or your family doctor is a place to begin. Sometimes parents are more comfortable starting that conversation with their pediatrician about their suspicions of drug use because they've already got a rapport going. They've been going to see that doctor for years for, you know, sick visits and routine medical visits. The pediatrician can be helpful in terms of ruling out medical causes for some of these symptoms that the child can be experiencing, drug testing, and also talking to the adolescent about how drugs affect the body and the brain from a medical standpoint. One thing I did want to mention about the signs and symptoms is that if a child is showing any of those signs and symptoms, and this is by no means an exhaustive list, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're using substances. It could be a sign of a mental health problem or a sign of another major stressor going on in their life, a traumatic event. There's any number of things that can be that can contribute to them having these kinds of signs and symptoms. The thing is it's hard to know as a parent what's going on, so that's why it's good to get a professional involved. So the pediatrician, other people that can be of help are psychiatrists, psychologists, professional counselors. If you have health insurance, you can check with your insurance company. Usually on the card, there's a number for behavioral health services. You can find out if you have coverage for behavioral health services, which encompasses substance abuse services and mental health services. Find out what treatment providers in your area provide treatment for substance abuse and if they participate with your insurance. Another resource is the Fairfax Falls Church Community Services Board, which serves the residents of the city of Falls Church and Fairfax County, both youth and adults. We provide substance abuse, mental health, and intellectual disability services. We have 4 locations around the county where youth can get assessments and receive outpatient treatment services. We have 1 location in Falls Church, which is very close to George Mason High School, another in South County, another in Reston, and 1 in Chantilly. And in these locations, you can make an appointment to go in with your child, have a very thorough clinical alcohol and drug and mental health assessment to determine what the problem is and what course of treatment is appropriate based on the results of the assessment. The assessment and any kind of treatment services are confidential. The CSB, the Community Services Board, also has 24-hour emergency services. That phone number is on the resource list that's on the table. There's also a card out there with quick access numbers for the CSB, Community Services Board, where you can make an appointment. You can also get my business card and call me if you'd like to talk about what you're seeing. A lot of parents are not sure that it's that they need to get an assessment or not. They're not sure if what they're seeing is really serious or if it's just teenage behavior, and that's something that we could talk about confidentially, and I can help you set up an appointment if that's something that seems appropriate and something that you want to do. Also on the resource list, I just want to mention a couple other things other than mental health professionals and professionals in the substance abuse field are some really great websites that parents can go to get some information. There's SAMHSA, which stands for Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. It's SAMHSA.gov. Got a lot of great information. It's also got a treatment locator on there. So you go to the website, you click on treatment locator, you click on the state, the zip code, and you can see what treatment providers provide services for substance abuse in that geographical location. So you can pull up a list and kind of start going through there, see if you do one for this location, CSB will pop up in there as one of them. Also, timetotalk.org and timetoact.org are really great in terms of lots of information about adolescent substance use, signs and symptoms, and particularly how to start the dialogue, how to have an ongoing dialogue with the child, how to answer difficult questions that inevitably come up when you're talking about the topic of substance abuse and the associated issues that come up, like traumatic events and things like that. Excuse me. Other resources include support groups. There's a really good one through the Fairfax County Juvenile Court System, and it's a parent support group. It's for parents to go when they feel like, you know, they've kind of lost control, or the kid's out of control, they're either, you know, they're truant from school, they're not following rules at home, they're maybe involved in alcohol or other drugs. The kids do not have to be court involved. It's, you know, just a walk-in group. It's every Tuesday night. It's a great parent support group. There's also other support groups like AA, Al-Anon, and Alateen for family members. The last thing that I want to talk about is 3 to succeed. We've talked a lot about the negative stuff, and we do need to talk about the negative stuff. We need to know what some of the warning signs are to look for so that we can try to catch them. We also need to talk about the realities of substance abuse, the consequences of substance abuse, and the dangers of substance abuse, not just among the parents, but also with adolescents, with their kids, so that they understand what the dangers are. But we also need to talk about what the positives are. So there's something called 3 to succeed, and the three to succeed is a concept based on the Fairfax County Youth Survey analysis that shows that just having just three assets, and I'll talk about what some of the assets are, having just three assets dramatically reduces risk behaviors. And some of these assets, they've had about 10, and in this particular, on the handout, you'll see there's 6 that they sort of analyzed here. Things like success in school, getting good grades, involved in the decision making. So kids have some kind of involvement in the decision making of the family. Now, don't let them make all the decisions, you know, but they feel like they're involved in the choices and they have some control in what's going on in their family. They have adults in their neighborhood, that they can talk to. Their parents notice when they're doing a good job. They're involved in extracurricular activities. They're involved in community service. Those are just 6 of the assets. And what they show is that kids who have 3 of those assets, they dramatically reduce their risk behaviors, such as sexual activity, alcohol use, cigarette use, binge drinking, violence, marijuana use, being involved in a gang. So what parents can do, there's some things parents can do right away that are not, some of them kind of simple, some of them might be difficult. This one is hopefully easy. Spend time with your teen, talk to them about things they like to talk about, things that they're interested in, engage them in those kinds of conversations. One of the assets is having kids feeling like they can go to their parent with a problem. So be someone that they can talk to and let them know that that they can come to you if they're having an issue. It's hard enough already for them to bring things to parents oftentimes, so let them know that you're there for them. Eating meals as a family as frequently as possible, that's a simple and effective way. It's one of the most simple and effective ways to have a set time where parents and kids engage with one another. Praise your child's good decisions and their hard work, not just their achievements, but praise them for, you know, being diligent, for sticking with it, for working their butt off, you know, week after week after week to get that, to make that achievement. Build a network of your child's friends and parents, share information and ideas, provide structures and rules and enforce them consistently. Help them find safe adults they can talk to. Again, they have to have, it's important for them to have safe adults that they can talk to in the neighborhood, in the school. Know where your child is after school, encourage them to do recreational activities, extracurricular activities. And then last but not least, as a reiteration, communicate with your child. Again, communicating with them not only about just how they're doing and what's going on and what they're interested in, but also have those conversations and communicate with them about the dangers of substance use. Explain to them what your values are about it, what your rules are about it, what your expectations are. Be very clear. If you're ambiguous, they will take that to mean that they will take that to mean approval. Ambiguity equals approval. You have to be very clear if your stance is that it's not that you don't approve of it, be very clear that you don't approve of it and why. I think I mentioned this, the last thing I wanted to say, that kids who learn a lot about the dangers of drugs from their parents are, according to studies, are up to 50% less likely to use them. So what you say and what you do really has a tremendous impact on the choices that they make. That's it.
One of the things that I forgot to mention that is important, a lot of the stats are showing that alcohol is a gateway to, you know, to doing other substance abuses. And to give you an idea, in the youth survey, 20% of elementary kids said that they've done it, you know, alcohol before they graduated sixth grade. That's a large number. But even more alarming is nearly 7% said that they've done inhalants as well in elementary school. And I know that these numbers are alarming, but we have to recognize, you know, what's going on out there so that us as a community can help support and do what we can to help others. It obviously starts at home, but it does take an army, you know, to start to make changes. The other thing I wanted to bring up is, and I don't know, has anybody here heard of K2 spice? That is banned in most states, but that doesn't mean it's still not sold on the internet and so forth. But also what's showing up on shelves and soon to show up on shelves is the fact that they're just changing the chemical components. Still does the same thing, but to get by the laws until somebody passes a law not to do that chemical makeup. For those who don't know what K2 spice is, it's a synthetic marijuana, for lack of better words. These kids that ingest it or smoke it get a high that's really not even similar to smoking marijuana, and can be deadly as well because of the chemicals, and it's highly addictive as well. So and the other thing to be on a lookout out there for is bath salts. These, and Karen, you might be able to share what the from what I understand, it's more of a kind of an opiate kind of experience with bath salts.
More of a cocaine type of
More of a cocaine.
I believe, yes.
These things that they can get on the internet. Kids are smart. They're using it. They, you know, word of mouth gets out there. Parents, you may not know of this stuff, but kids kind of talk to each other, and it kind of grows like wildfire. If kids, you know, hey, try this. They can get this stuff on the internet, in some cases in some of the stores. And most of you have probably heard of Four Loko. It's a drink that has 12% alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
To give you an idea of what 12% alcohol, if they drank two of those Four Lokos, it's like drinking two bottles of wine. And good thing is that they at least remove some of the stimulants that were in it that would keep a kid preventing them from passing out. Can you imagine drinking two bottles of wine and still be coherent? These kids, we had a death in our community from a young man that drank Four Loko. He drank two in a matter of a short time. The police caught him, called the parents up at the place where the concert was. By the time they got home, he was so out of his mind, but still awake, that he ran away from the car. By the time they found him in the middle of the road, where he just sat in the middle of the road and got ran over by a truck. And we lost a young man just from, and he didn't know, he was out of his mind, you know, unfortunately, caused by this drink. But these are the kind of things that we've constantly got to battle as a community to try to keep the awareness out there. It's very important. I mean, like I says, if you can save one life, it has an impact for many generations.
Well, we want to thank you all for letting us speak with you this evening and have some dialogue about substance abuse. PROTECT is a task force of the Unified Prevention Coalition of Fairfax County. We're a nonprofit, and we're happy to go around and talk to other parent and student groups about this issue. And we hope we opened up some dialogue and answered a few questions and just made you a little bit more aware of what's going on. Again, thank you.
Thank you.